Parikshit Maharaj had inquired of Dharma, personified as Bull, as to the cause of his suffering. And Dharma had given a very philosophical answer, which essentially tackles this issue of determining who is the doer. And we had this discussion that any activity that is done, there are multiple doers. And because of various factors, it is difficult to identify who is the actual doer. Is it the person who is performing that particular activity? Is it the person on whom the activity is being performed? Is it Krishna? Is it the demigods? So there are so many different factors. So when Dharma was speaking in this philosophical way, then Parikshit Maharaj in the previous verse, then he speaks, and it says he speaks without any doubt and with certainty. And what does he speak? He says that you are Dharma. You are Dharma because only one who understands the intricacies of karma can speak in such a way. So it is easy for one to speak in a philosophical way while they're sitting under a tree and having a discussion, or as they say, when the person is an armchair philosopher. But Dharma was in a different situation. He was actually being beaten by the personification of Kali, and he does not turn his finger to Kali and say, this is a person. At that point, he is actually looking for a deeper philosophical cause. So in addition to the causes that Dharma has given in the previous verses, Maharaj Parikshit also derives one more cause. And the cause that he gives is that if one identifies with the perpetrator, then one actually gets the same destination. So Sridhar Swami in this, when he comments on this verse, he paraphrases what Parikshit Maharaj is saying. So he says that Parikshit Maharaj says that you are speaking according to a religious principle as follows. If it has not been proven, one should not point him out, even knowing the killer. Therefore, you are Dharma. Why pointing out is explained in the next sentence, beginning with Yada Dharma, you get the same destination. So Burjan Prabhu, he expands on this and he says that Dharma is responding implicitly to Maharaj Parikshit, that you have questioned me about the identity of the one who caused my suffering. In fact, I'm unable to tell you, for I have been confused by the many different philosophical opinions about who actually is the doer. Some philosophers say that due to karma, one causes his own difficulties. Others claim that the suffering is caused by Brahman, the Lord's spiritual effulgence, which is the supreme supernatural power. Some others say that the indwelling Paramatma, by giving memory, forgetfulness, and inspiration, causes suffering. Still others, the atheists, say that there is no cause that exists beyond material nature. Some insist that the true cause is unknowable. O sage among kings, please therefore reach your own conclusion with your own intelligence and decide who has caused my pain. So Burjan Prabhu has essentially summarized all the verses in the conversation earlier on as to what is the reason that Dharma is refusing to identify the doer. And in this verse, one another reason is added is that, or rather you can say two reasons are added. First is that when you identify somebody as the cause of your suffering, you get situated in duality of friend and enemy. So duality is in itself a cause of one's downfall. The second reason is given is the example of the what is known as a grass worm. That grass worm is confined by a bee, and the grass worm it meditates on the bee and becomes the bee. So similarly, when one identifies the perpetrator of one's misfortune, then by meditating on that perpetrator, one acquires similar qualities. So because of these two reasons, these two additional reasons, dharma is not identifying. Now, there is a third reason that is coming out implicitly over here. And the point that dharma is trying to make, that why are you asking me as to who is the cause of my suffering when both of us know that Krishna is the cause of all causes? So you should understand that Krishna is the only one who is Swarat, who is fully independent. He is the only one that can be attributed to acting without any external implications. Everybody else is acting because of certain implications. Karma because of my own activity, and enmity because of duality. So everybody is acting because of some implication, but Krishna is Swarat. So only the person who is independent can be held accountable, right? Because if an animal comes and bites you, in this country they do it, if an animal bites, they'll kill the animal. But really speaking, it's not the animal's fault, because the animal is acting according to its propensity. So if one is forced to act, then one lacks the accountability, right? If a child comes and breaks something, then the child is not responsible, because it's simply acting according to its own nature. So only when there is independence, there is accountability. So what dharma is saying is that there is only one person who is truly independent, and that is Krishna. So why are you asking me all this question when you know that Krishna is the cause of it? But the reason that he's not saying it, because as a devotee, one devotee speaking to another devotee, he's reluctant to point a finger at Krishna as the cause of his suffering. So the acharyas say that what he is implying is Krishna is the cause of it, and the reason that he is doing it is for my purification and your glorification. So which is again factual. So Prabhupada in the purport, he writes, Maharaj Parikshit observed this, and therefore he could understand that the bull was no other than the personality of religion himself. In other words, a devotee has no suffering at all, because so-called suffering is also God's grace for a devotee who sees God in everything. The cow and the bull never placed any complaint before the king for being tortured by the personality of Kali, although everyone lodges such complaint before the state authorities. The extraordinary behavior of the bull made the king conclude that the bull was certainly the personality of religion, for no one else could understand the finer intricacies of the code of religion. Okay, next verse 23. Atva deva maya ya nunam gatir agochara cheteso vachachaschapi bhutanam iti nishchayah. Thus it is concluded that the Lord's energies are inconceivable. No one can estimate them by mental speculation or by word jugglery. So this verse is giving credence to the implication of the acharyas attributing dharma's reluctance to point a finger. So by this verse we can understand that deep within his heart he understands that all this is because of Krishna. That's why he's saying that the Lord's energies are inconceivable. Now the way dharma is speaking, it includes Krishna and it excludes Krishna also, because all the other causes are also Krishna's energies. Karma is Krishna's energy. The other jivas are also Krishna's energy. Kali is also, time is also Krishna's energy. So he's including all the other factors, but he's also bringing the focus to Krishna. That while the other factors are conceivable, the Krishna factor is inconceivable. Karma is conceivable because you know bad things happen to when bad people, when things do bad activities, and good things happen when people do good activities. Kaal is conceivable by the influence of time. Demoniac principles are conceivable, but Krishna is not conceivable. They are all energies of Krishna, but Krishna is not conceivable. So in a very subtle way, dharma is now bringing the attention to Krishna. So in the 20th verse, dharma had said, iti keshva api nishchaya, that thus it needs to be concluded. So Maharaj Parikshit, he responds to that by stating his own authoritative conclusion. He says the cause is apratakyat, beyond the power of reasoning. Anirdeshyat, beyond the power of thinking. Why? Because Krishna is achintaya. So the course of Lord's energy, which causes maintenance and destruction of the whole universe, Deva Maya, is beyond the mind, Chetesha. It is beyond words. And because Maya is under the control of Krishna, one can understand that both happiness and distress in the form of maintenance of destruction is under the control of Krishna. So Jiva Goswami in Krama Sandarbha, he says that in this verse, Maharaj Parikshit is saying to Dharma, it is proper that a person authoritative in protecting all Dharma to speak the truth. Why say that you do not know, though you are a devotee of the Lord? And then he answers his own question. But now, by the influence of time created by the Lord's Maya, this doubt is suitable for you. So the word Deva is used with Maya to indicate that Krishna has nothing to do with Maya directly, but it is Krishna's divine arrangement that enables Maya. So Prabhupada in the purport, he expands on this. He says that a question may be raised as to why a devotee should refrain from identifying an actor, although he knows definitely that the Lord is the ultimate doer of everything. Knowing the ultimate doer, one should not pose himself as ignorant of the actual perform. To answer this doubt, the reply is that the Lord is not directly responsible, for everything is done by his deputed Maya Shakti or material energy. The material energy is always provoking doubts about the supreme authority of the Lord. The personality of religion knew very well that nothing can take place without the sanction of the Supreme Lord, and still he was put into doubts by the deluding energy. And thus he refrained from mentioning the supreme cause. This doubtfulness was due to the contamination of both Kali and the material energy. The whole atmosphere of the age of Kali is magnified by the deluding energy, and the proportion of measurement is inexplicable. So, So what we are seeing over here is, as I had mentioned earlier on, this whole discussion about the identity of the actual doer is philosophically very dense. In the initial part, Dharma had identified some doers while stating that he is not in a position to identify the ultimate doer. Now, Maharaj Parikshit is extrapolating and identifying some more doers. And ultimately, they are all working in some kind of a collaborative fashion to give the results. But one always tries to find who the ultimate doer is. And Prabhupada over here says that Dharma is not able to identify Krishna as the ultimate doer because of two things. Because in the material world, everybody is conditioned, influence of Maya. Second reason is the age of Kali. In the age of Kali, this illusion becomes even more magnified. Now, bear in mind that these are not the exclusive causes. So what's happening here is, in every verse, additional causes are being layered. And I think at the end of the next verse, I'll summarize all the causes that have been placed so far. So let us take a step back and try and look at this more philosophical question of why does Krishna cause suffering? That if Parikshit Maharaj is saying that actually Krishna is the cause, but Dharma is not identifying it because being deluded, then he seems to indicate that Krishna is the cause of suffering. So factually, we begin with a negation. Krishna does not cause suffering. The suffering is created by the jiva. Why? The cause of the suffering is because they are in illusion as to who is the doer. In this whole creation, there are only two conscious entities. There is Krishna and there is jiva. There are only two doers. There is Krishna and there is jiva. Krishna is the ultimate doer. Jiva is the secondary doer. Other than that, there is no other doer. So we have reduced our scope of discussion now to two factors, Krishna and jiva. So the root cause of the suffering of the jiva is not doing its duty. And the next statement is in italics for emphasis. So for those of you who are taking notes, should make a note of it. Our duty is what we are made of and what we are made for. So we are made of spirit and we are made for the service of the Supreme Spirit. So this is a definition of duty. That our duty is what we are made of and what we are made for. We are made of spirit and we are made for the service of the Supreme Spirit. Until the time we don't understand this duty, we will suffer. As soon as we understand the duty, our suffering will cease. So you see that we first reduce the agents of the suffering to two, Krishna and Jiva. And now we have anchored the needle to the Jiva. And the root cause of it is that denial of our duty. So an example that is given over here is that of Vidur. So when Duryodhan kicked Vidur out of the palace, he had two options. He could have identified Duryodhan as the cause of his suffering, or he could have identified Krishna as being the prime mover. Or more than Krishna, he could have seen it in terms of his own dharma. So if he had identified Duryodhana as the cause of his suffering, then he would have been trapped in the cycle of karma. He would have taken a position of enmity towards Duryodhana, he would have conspired against him, and then that cycle would have gone. But what Vidur did in the situation was, he looked at it in terms of his dharma. What am I made of? And what am I made for? And what did he do? That he took this opportunity to re-establish himself in the service of Krishna. And because of that, not only did he not suffer, he became the shelter of others who were suffering. So if one does not see Krishna's hand behind it all, then one will react to the person in the duality of a friend or enemy. So dharma, he sees Krishna as the cause and he's responding as per the desire of Krishna. But yet, he's not identifying Krishna directly. And Parikshit Maharaj, he divines, saying that the reason you're not identifying Krishna is because of the layer of contamination. So let us summarize that what are the reasons of the main points that are made by Dharma and Parikshit Maharaj in terms of identifying the cause of suffering. First is, the laws of Dharma are complex, and identifying them and applying them to identify the real doer is difficult. So this, if you'll remember, is Dharma saying that there are different systems of philosophy. One says this, one says another. So it's difficult. So that is the first reason. Second is that if it has not been proven, one should not point out to a doer, because that would be adharmic. So the second point flows from the first point. Because dharma is, the laws of dharma is complex, identifying the perpetrator is difficult. The second point is that if you identify the perpetrator without having unequivocal understanding of him, then that itself is sinful. Third reason is, if you identify the perpetrator as the cause of your suffering, then you're identifying with the perpetrator. So you become like the perpetrator. So we had that example of the grass worm thinking like the bee and becoming the bee. So somebody is doing bad to you, you keep thinking of the qualities of that person, you become like that. You become like that person. Fourth understanding is that everyone, with the exception of Krishna, is dependent. So how can they be the doer? So how can you identify one tied person whose hands are tied, as doing something to another person whose hands are tied? Fifth point is that a devotee will see the hand of Krishna everywhere and will act in a way to please Krishna. Sixth is, Krishna is achintya. And while it is easy to philosophically understand that Krishna is the ultimate doer, why he is doing it is next to impossible, because Krishna is inconceivable. This is the point made by Bhishma Dev in his prayers when he points towards Krishna and he says that he is doing all this, but why is he doing it? His plans are known only to him and nobody else. Seventh point is that Krishna's external energy is bewildering both the doer and the victim. So, difficult for one mad person to identify another mad person. If two mad people are fighting with one another, difficult for one person to identify the other person. And the final point is, in the age of Kali, there is so much contamination that this philosophical purity that is needed is completely lacking. So because of all these points made by Dharma, and some of them are implicitly made by Dharma but brought forward by Parikshit Maharaj, there is an inability to point to who the doer is. So Burijan Prabhu, he tries to explain this a little bit more by giving an actual, by using an example. So he says that an accurate understanding of what occurs therefore exists on more than one level. If one is unreasonably beaten with a stick, he will be injured and must defend himself or suffer great pain. Despite the beating being ultimately God's grace, the beater may not have one's best interest in mind. Dealing on this level demands prompt and practical action. While acting practically, however, one should nevertheless remember Krishna's ultimate control, because Krishna is the ultimate doer. Maintaining that awareness while acting will free one from envy, anxiety, and anger, and one will carry and will carry one to Krishna's lotus feet. Seeing all that occurs as Krishna's will, a devotee understands that not a blade of grass moves without the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Such a person remains free of anxiety even amongst the greatest difficulties. Still, along with maintaining this vision, he must act practically while simultaneously remaining detached from the results of his action. On still another level, more than Krishna's desires causes, on still another level, more than Krishna's desires causes are circumstances. And then later on, he talks about 10.14, Tatyanukampam Sumikshamano, the mood of a devotee, practicing devotee, that you tolerate the things that are happening to you while patiently waiting for Krishna's mercy. So Prabhupada, this is one of those deep philosophical points. Prabhupada has many lectures on it. I don't have the time to go over it, but if you look at the Prabhupada's lecture on this verse, there are actually many lectures in which Prabhupada he comments on this verse, essentially to make this point that the devotee sees Krishna's hand everywhere, and by seeing that hand, he gets freed from anxiety, and he tries to act in a way that would please Krishna. So seeing Krishna's hand does not make the person inactive, but makes the person even more active. So if a person is being beaten by a stick, then saying that this is the will of Krishna, one does not just sit quietly and get beaten by a stick. But then what the person tries to see that, what does Krishna want me to do? And then act according to that. Okay, so let me pause over here and see if there is any questions or comments.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, I comment, it's quite complex to remember all this. I think the last part is the most important now, that we, everything is done by Krishna for our own good at the end of the day.
Right. It's easy for us to resonate with that because, you know, as devotees, that's the platform that we try to anchor ourselves at, that everything is done by Krishna's desire. And I think where the rubber hits the road is when this philosophy hits the experience part. So you're going down your life, and sometimes we see in the life of devotees that they face a lot of trials and tribulations. And then seeing Krishna's hand over there, from an experiential basis, it is difficult there. So that's what Bhurijan Prabhu says, that while we anchor ourselves philosophically in that notion, from a practical perspective, we act according to our level of realization. So one who is truly surrendered to Krishna can basically be like Draupadi and put one's hands up and say that, you know, if you want to protect me, protect me. If you want to kill me, kill me. But for those who are not, then they act according to the level of realization, which is our situation, right? Sometimes adversity happens. So we have sufficient understanding of the philosophy to know that Krishna is ultimately causing it. But from a practical perspective, we do not have that level of forbearance to simply tolerate that suffering. So then we react to the suffering, but when we react to it, we again try to see that what is the best way that Krishna would want us to react to that. Like Vidur Maharaj, right? He reacted to the suffering by going out on a tirtha. At another level, Vidur could have simply stayed. He could have simply stayed in the palace, let Duryodhan, understanding this is not Duryodhan but Krishna, but according to his own realization, the best thing for him was to leave the palace and go on a tirtha. And that was his steps to perfection.
Prabhu, if we take the example of Sudama as well.
Right. Sudama is another example that he was going through a lot of suffering and he was constantly seeing Krishna's hand there. So, and ultimately he used it for his own purification. When he goes to Dwarka, even though his wife sends him to get wealth, but he actually goes there to get Krishna's darshan. So that's another example. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. So does that mean that, like, you know, when we are not reacting to situations, adverse situations, mostly, is that like the sign of more, like, you know, sign of full surrender, rather than if we are reacting and then surrendering? Like,
you're right. If one is able to tolerate the suffering, then that's the whole tatyenu kampam sumikshamaro, that one simply tolerates the suffering.
Well, just waiting. Sorry, so, like, I'm not like tolerate. Yeah, like, say for example, if somebody loses their job, right? And so the practical, like, you know, I mean, like, you know, if somebody is on my level, for example, they will start looking for another job. But if somebody is, like, say, more advanced, then like, you know, fully surrendered and fully dependent, then they would probably do more devotional service in that. Like, I'm just trying to understand, like, what is when somebody has realized that Krishna is the cause of all causes and he's the reason behind everything, what is their reaction? So is a reaction like, you know, like, for example, Draupadi, right? Like, she tried her best to during that whole episode to, like, protect herself, but then you know, when she felt that her strength was not enough, she, like, you know, completely surrendered. So our reaction is like, I mean, the fact that we are reacting is basically tells that we are not there yet.
I guess using the word reacting, you're right. But I think I liked your earlier example a little bit more relevant, that, you know, when you lose your job, then whether you find another job or use that as an opportunity to to become a full-time devotee, that neither of them is good or bad, or both can be good or bad. What is correct is basically trying to divine that what is the best way for you to make spiritual advancements. And that becomes the, you know, that becomes the proper reaction to it. So you lose your job, and then you know, and then you move into the temple. I know the example of one person that had this case, that lost the job, tried to get a job, did not get it, moved to the temple, and caused a lot of disturbance in the temple, and within a few years moved out of the temple. So externally you would think, wow, great, you know, persons use this opportunity to surrender to Krishna. But more important is the fact that did that cause an increase in the surrender? So whether by doing another job, if that causes increase of surrender, that's a recommended path. And yes, you know, if moving to the temple causes increased surrender, that is the recommended path. Ultimately, the recommendation is, what is it that will increase your sense of surrender? Okay, so so I do realize that this is a little complicated, and unfortunately it does not get any easier. It gets a little bit more so I'll try and see how best to help, or you know, or maybe you guys have figured it all out. So
no, Prabhuji, is very complicated.
Sure, complicated for me. I'll see what's the best way. So let's move to the next verse, 117:24. So this is basically another complicated verse, but in this I'm going to send you my notes. So if you can just focus on the discussion and don't worry too much about writing, I'll send my notes to Prem Kishore Prabhu and Achyuta, and then they can disperse it to the group. Okay, so verse 24. Tapasocham daya satyam itipada krita krita adharmam shesatrayo bhagna smaya sangamadeistava. In the age of satya, truthfulness, your four legs were established by the four principles of austerity, cleanliness, mercy, and truthfulness. But it appears the three of your legs are broken due to rampant irreligion in the form of pride, lust for women, and intoxication. So Maharaj Parikshit, he's agreeing with Dharma that it is difficult to identify the real perpetrator. Now, earlier on, he was saying that maybe it is because of the bewildering influence of the age of Kali. But now he's modifying that statement and says that it's been happening since time immemorial. He's saying that right from the time of Satyuga, age of Satya, right from the time of Satyuga, this bewilderment has started. So the point that is making is that it is by the influence of time, that it is because of the irrevocable influence of time that this confusion is intensifying more and more. And how do we understand the influence of time? So we understand that by the fact that the individual karmas of the jivas collectively, they manifest in the quality of dharma and adharma for that particular age. And thus they create a certain kind of they color that particular age. So the individuals together, they create a composite karma And that composite karma colors the yuga. So this is explained in two verses, in this verse and next verse. So this verse is also important because it talks about the four regulative principles. If you look at the verse, it's talking about the four regulative principles. And I had sent, so Prem Kishore Prabhu, if you can put that table on the screen. So I sent a table that describes the cause and effect and subsequent effects of these four regulative principles. And then I can talk you through it. Without it, it's a little difficult for me to explain. You have that document, Prabhu?
Yeah, 1 second, Prabhu. I'm opening it.
Okay, Prabhu. So while Prabhu is opening it, I wanted to quote a verse by Sridhar Swami where he says, Smyana tapaha sangena saucham madena daya anartena satyametabam. And he's essentially establishing the cause and effect between these four pillars of dharma and its influence on the four ages of Satya, Treta, Dwapar and Kali Yuga. Okay, thank you, Prabhu. So keep this table in mind, and I'll talk through the what from left to right what the table talks about. So the first thing to go in Satyuga is humility, and humility. So, Prem Kishore Prabhu, you want to mute your computer? Thank you, Prabhu. So, the first thing to go in Satyuga is humility. So, the humility is lost by excessive pride in one's own value system, which results in rejecting the words of the scriptures. As a result of this, it minimizes the value of the lives of others. Such people will kill animals for sacrifice based on their own interpretation of the Vedas. They will justify the killing of animals based on their own desire to ascend to higher planets and on their own desires to enjoy the flesh of these animals. So the scriptural recommendation of the denial of senses is no longer followed, and the pillar of austerity or tapa is destroyed. So this is the first leg of dharma that is destroyed in the age of Satya Yuga. Now, with the lack of austerity, so we see that austerity is compromised. So with the lack of austerity, the ability to control the mind and senses is compromised. Purity is manifested by the control of mind over senses, both subtle and gross. So when the mind control weakens, then what happens? Then the senses rule. And when the senses rule, then one is in a state of prominently in a state of lust. The strongest manifestation of lust is attraction to the opposite sex. So one can only follow celibacy by having strong control on the mind and senses. And then conversely, one who lacks self-control will indulge in illicit sex. So the lack of austerity leads to the lack of self-control, which leads to illicit sex. And by the engagement in illicit sex, saucham or purity is now compromised. So this is what happens in the Treta Yuga. Now a person that is bewildered by following the urges of the senses. Why is the person bewildered? Because they are thinking that if I follow my senses, I will get happiness. So they're following the urges of the senses prominently by engaging in illicit sex, but there is no happiness there. So what does the person take to? He says that the best thing for me to do is to numb my mind to this constant suffering. What is the way to numb the mind? By intoxication. So with the numbing of the mind, the intrinsic quality of empathy is mitigated. So empathy means that feeling like the other person. Pathos is feeling and M is to be like. So empathy is you feel like what the other person is feeling. So when this quality of empathy is mitigated, then the pillar of mercy is compromised. Because mercy essentially is that I feel your pain. I feel, and there's a term, it's more of a slang actually. It says like, I feel you, which basically means that I empathize with you. But when that is compromised, the pillar of mercy is now compromised. That happens in Dwapar Yuga. So intoxication results in illusion, which is a complete lack of understanding of what is real and what is not. So in this stage, one sees happiness where it is not and distress where it is not. So one is now situated in falsity. So one is looking upon happiness as distress and distress as happiness. So one is now situated in falsity. So the quality of satyam is not just speaking the truth, but seeing the truth. It means being true to yourself. It means being true to others. And ultimately, it means being true to the scriptures. So when you say that a person is sat, it means that the person is acting as per the Vedas. The devotees are called satvatas because they have this quality in them. As sat weakens, it manifests in the other three vices also. So satyam is the last to go because it is the basis of everything. When it is gone, nothing else remains. And the loss of truth manifests in gambling. So many times we say gambling means like playing cards or playing the market, which it is. But gambling also means stealing by deceit. So what does a person stealing by deceit? The person is stealing the lives of others by deceit, which is meat eating. The person is stealing the body of others by deceit, which is illicit sex. The person is stealing one's own sanity by deceit, which is intoxication. And ultimately, the person is seeking his own fidelity by deceit, which is lack of truthfulness. And what is the deceit over here? The deceit is that while the person is stealing, the person is justifying it as the right thing to do. So that is the lying that is happening over here. So being truthful is the basis of making spiritual advancements. And when one gives up this quality of being truthful, one begins by rejecting the scriptures and everything else will follow. And it follows in stages. So first it manifests as a lack of austerity, then as purity, and then of mercy. And then finally, it lacks in our own daily interaction, just the way that we conduct ourselves or what we speak. So finally, the pillar of truthfulness is now compromised. So another way to understand this is by considering the analogy of a house that is being demolished. So if a house has several floors, when the top floor of the house is demolished, the house is still there. But you say that the top story is gone. The next floor is demolished, is still there. You say now two stories are gone. Only when the foundation of the house is demolished will you say that the house is now destroyed. So the foundation is the one that gets destroyed the last. So truthfulness is the one that is destroyed the last, which implies that satyam is the foundation of all the other qualities. While satyam is there, it is supporting the quality of mercy. Mercy is supporting the quality of purity, and purity is supporting the quality of austerity. And as per Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he says that satyam is the cause of all good qualities, and meat eating is the root of all vices. Those who commit violence to living entities through meat eating have no austerity, no purity, and no mercy. This is the cause of all adharmas. The building is supported from the bottom up and is destroyed from the top down. The foundation builds up from truthfulness, and the destruction goes down from the lack of austerity. So this is an understanding of the interplay between the four legs of dharma, how they are supporting dharma and how they are destroyed. Now, I'm guessing this should be clear. There is another aspect of the impact of these pillars that are being destroyed, which is what is the Yuga Dharma. So in the 12th canto, Parikshit Maharaj or Sukadeva Goswami says to Parikshit Maharaj, Maharaj Kriti Adhyayate Vishru Tretayam Yajita Maka Dwapare Paricharyayam Kalotadhari Kirtana. Whatever results are obtained in Satyug by meditation on Vishnu, in Treta Yug by performing sacrifices, and in Dwapar Yug by serving the Lord's lotus feet, can be obtained in Kali Yug simply by chanting the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. So why is it that these four yugas have different four recommended practice? The reason is because of the mitigation of these principles of dharma. So this is explained in the 11th canto, 5th chapter, from verses 22 to 32, in this famous conversation between Karbhajan, who is one of the Navyugendras, and Maharaj Nimi. So in this conversation, the famous verse also appears about the appearance of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So let's see how are the two correlated. So the meditation, so Kriti Adhyayate Vishnu. So in Satyug, meditation is recommended. And meditation requires a high level of austerity, since it needs extensive penances to be performed. When austerity is mitigated, penances are not possible, so meditation is not possible. So we come to the next yuga, which is the performance of yajna. In order to perform yajnas, what do you need? Qualified Brahmins who are clean in mind, words, and action, as well as you need cleanliness in the environment. So when the quality of purity is mitigated, that is not possible. So by the end of Dwapar Yuga, yajna is no longer possible. So next comes temple worship. So temple worship requires the quality of congregational participation under the guidance of qualified priests. So the king and the congregation, they both support this, and the primary quality is that of mercy. So the mercy to others. So the king does it as a symbol of mercy to the praja. The people do it as a symbol of mercy to each other. The Brahmins do it as a symbol of mercy to the other castes. But when people lose this quality of mercy, they become more self-centered with their time, with their wealth, and with their knowledge. So this process of temple worship also becomes mitigated. So in the age of Kali, chanting is recommended. All that chanting requires is satyam. Satyam means being true to the Yuga Dharma. And the Yuga Dharma is chanting. As one becomes less and less true, even that becomes mitigated. So that's how these four practices in the four ages are impacted by the destruction of the four legs. So because the acharyas, it's a little, I was debating whether I should include this in the discussion or not, but I do want to include it because I'm discussing with people who are mature practitioners. So there is a difference of an opinion also in this. According to Jiva Goswami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, the reduction in the four qualities is not sequential, but it is parallel. So the point that they make is that at the end of Satyuga, all the four qualities are depleted by 25%. At the end of Dwapar Yuga, they are depleted by another 25%, and so on. So what the point that they make is, it's not that one quality goes away, but all of them are being depleted. So at the beginning of Kali Yuga, you see that 75% of the four qualities have been depleted. So you see all the four qualities of purity, mercy, austerity, and truthfulness, but depleted to 1/4 of the level. So Sridhar Swami, he makes this point that there is no difference between these two conceptions. And so he says that the qualities are so intimately correlated to one another, that one is the cause of another and one is nourished by the other. So when you say that one quality is depleted or all four qualities are depleted, you're essentially saying the same thing. So both the conceptions actually mean the same. Another point that I would like to make also is that in this table, you know, we have established this correlation that when, because of austerity, lack of austerity results in meat eating. In the 12th canto, there is a slightly different correlation. So there it says that the lack of mercy results in meat eating. And both Jiva Goswami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that even though the statements are slightly different, you should understand that they are meaning the same thing. So they kind of leave it at that. So Srila Prabhupada in the purport, he makes the statement that the deluding energy or material nature can act upon the living beings proportionately in terms of the living beings falling prey to the deluding attraction of Maya. So then he says that we must always remember that false pride or too high an estimation of one's own values of life destroys austerity. So the destroys austerity part I'm adding in paren, just to complete the thought. Then Prabhupada says, undue attachment to women or association with them, that destroys purity. Intoxication destroys mercy and will divert the human civilization from the path of peace. However much the people clamor for peace in the world, so this is truthfulness, the preaching of the Bhagavatam principles will automatically render all men austere, clean, both inside and outside, merciful to the suffering, and truthful in daily behavior. That is the way of correcting the flaws of human society, which are very prominently exhibited at the current moment. Okay, so this is, I would not say it is exhaustive, But basically, this gives us some understanding of the four principles of religion, that what is the cause of them being diminishing and what is the result of them. And the result is also to some extent the cause. There is some amount of circularity over here. So like you say that, you know, austerity is destroyed by pride and results in meat eating. It's also fine to say that meat eating destroys austerity and results in pride. And it is also correct to say that pride destroys austerity and results in meat eating. So because these three things are sitting so close to one another, it is difficult to ascertain linear causality and effect. But the matter of fact is that they kind of appear like siblings. One a little before another, but not really being the cause. Maitreya Rishi in the third canto, and I put that just for the sake of completeness, he has attributed these four qualities to the different ashrams. So I've just put it over there. It does not really shed a lot of light in terms of what we have already added, but because it's spoken by Maitreya Rishi to Vidur, I've put it over there. Okay, so I'm going to go to the next verse, which also talks about these four qualities. And then I'll stop and see if there is any questions or comments. And like I said, that in addition to this table, the description that I've shared, I'll prepare that in a document, and then I will send it to Ashuta and Prem Kishore, and they can send it over. And then if anybody wants follow-up discussions, we can either have it in a class or we can have it offline. Okay, next verse, 25. Idanim dharma padaste satyam nirvataye dyataha tama jigrakshatya dharmoyam antrinaye ditaha kalihi. You are now standing on one leg only, which is truthfulness. And you're somehow or other hobbling along, but quarrel personified Kali, flourishing by deceit, is also trying to destroy that leg. So this is Parikshit Maharaj reflecting on the current state of affairs of Dharma. So of the four parts of Dharma, consisting of austerity, cleanliness, mercy, and truthfulness, only truthfulness remains. And the other three have been destroyed by pride, illicit sex, and intoxication. So truth is now the most prominent, since the others have diminished. Because of the truth, Vaishyamara says that nivratayet, that one can concentrate the mind to some extent. Or because of truth, a person can hope to attain the Param Satya, which is Krishna. But then Kali in the form of Adharma is doing Antrenta. Antrena means is increasing untruth or desiring to destroy truth. So this is also confirmed in the 12th canto of the Bhagavatam. So in the commentary of this verse, as I said, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that it is also okay to consider that all the four qualities are proportionately reducing over the four ages. And when we say that, when we identify a cause, we can identify it as the prime cause. So what it means is that in the Satyug, austerity is the prime cause of the reduction of all the four legs of Dharma. In the Treta Yug, purity is the cause. In the Dwapar Yug, mercy. And now in the Kali Yug, truthfulness. So one may question that why is Parishad Maharaj saying that Dharma is standing on only one leg? And Jiva Goswami, he explains over here that one leg remains with a quarter of the four parts of Dharma. So basically, a quarter of four is the same as one. And in that, a portion of truth remains. So Srila Prabhupada in the purport also speaks something similar. This peace of mind was complete in Satyuga because of the existence of above mentioned attributes of the human beings. Gradually, these attributes have diminished in Treta Yuga to 3/4, in Dwapar to half, and in this Kali age of Kali to 1/4, which is also diminishing by account of prevailing untruthfulness. By pride, either artificial or real, the resultant action of austerity is spoiled. By too much affection to female association, cleanliness is spoiled. By too much addiction to intoxication, mercy is spoiled. By too much lying propaganda, truthfulness is spoiled. The revival of Bhagavad Dharma can save human civilization from falling prey to the evils of all description. So Prabhupada is basically expanding on what Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur says, that all the four aspects are proportionately declining. So I'll stop here briefly. I'll stop here and see if there's any comments.
Prabhu, just one comment. Last time in one of the class, you said that illicit sex is the most difficult to control out of the four.
That is true, Prabhu. That because it is a representative of the control of mind and senses, it is from in the current day and age, that is the most difficult to control.
Okay, now when you say, when in the purport, Prabhupada, by too much affection for female association, you know, what does that mean? You should not even speak to the opposite sex?
In a way that you want to exploit them. So if you look at the earlier cause, that if one looks upon, and I guess it is true both ways, even though generally it is used in the context of women, but if you look upon the opposite sex as an opportunity to exploit, then that is not recommended. If you associate for the purpose of spiritual advancement, if you associate in the mood of service, that's the kind of sangha that increases one's progress in spirituality. So that is obviously recommended.
And then also we found out in some of the past time that I don't remember the name, but some Rishi Muni, they had their wife with them. They never take sannyas, they never separate, but they were together all the time, even at the time of, they get into the fire together. And they help each other actually to progress spiritually.
So thank you, Russo. That's an example. That's an answer to your question. That association with women, it's not universally condemned, but association in the mode of exploiting is condemned. And where is it that, like the example that you're given, where the husband and the wife together are serving each other and in the spiritual practices, then it is actually glorified.
Okay, I will just take an example, okay? For example, yourself and here also, me alone, I cannot do many things. Let's say we do program, we host people and all that. Impossible one person, but as a team, it's being done as a team. And you know what I'm trying to say.
Right, and that's the mood of. Not looking at your partner in an exploitative mood, but looking at the partner as a companion and devotee, as a devotee companion in making spiritual advancements. And so that's obviously not an example of. So what it's called here is three sangha, and the sangha is basically has a connotation of for the sake of sense gratification.
Okay, thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. Good point.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, in that table that you shared, if you just look at the results, so that, you know, meat eating, that becomes a cause of illicit sex, that becomes a cause of intoxication, that becomes a cause of gambling. So it seems like that is the flow. But then, you know, like you mentioned, truthfulness, that is basically the base of all the other three. So on the other side, so if you look at again that from that angle, then it seems like gambling, leads to intoxication, and then that leads to illicit sex, and that leads to meat eating. So I'm just confused, which one is the cause, the base cause for the others.
So gambling is the result. So gambling is it's a term that we use, so that's why I put it there. But basically, gambling is equivalent to speculation. So the point I made was that when one begins to speculate on the truth, and the ultimate truth that we speculate on is the word of the Vedas, Krishna is Sat, the Param Satya, we start speculating on that. So that's when the foundation of the house begins to shake. And then, it basically spirals up also. So actually, when I gave you the chain of cause and effect, I went from top to bottom. You know, I basically spoke about how the lack of austerity results in the lack of purity, results in a lack of mercy, and ultimately lack of truthfulness. But the reason that I say that truthfulness is the foundation, because it is the last to go. It is always there. Truthfulness is there in austerity, purity, and mercy. Mercy is there in austerity and purity. And purity is there in austerity. So when austerity goes, then purity and mercy and truthfulness are still retained. Similarly, when purity goes, mercy is still retained. So if you think of it in terms of the house being demolished from the top down, when the top floor goes, the third floor is still there. So just because the fourth floor is gone, because the third floor is supporting the fourth floor, not the other way around. So the house is built from bottom up. So that's why we say that truthfulness supports mercy, supports purity, supports austerity. But when the destruction is happening, then it is coming from the top down, where austerity goes, and then purity and mercy, and then truthfulness.
Thank you, Rahul. So even I had read about that meat eating is basically mercy, that kills mercy. I mean, like you mentioned that, you know, in the 12th canto it mentions that way. So then from this table, meat eating will lead to the other things, but then from the other table, will it be intoxication that leads to other?
It's a good question. This took me a while to straighten up. And if I was if you read the 12th canto, the flow is at a more general level. And let me read out to you. The reason I didn't want to bring it is because it confuses something that is already it's already confusing. So
yeah, but the whole class is very heavy.
Right. So in the 12th canto, it comes a little differently. It's, you know, it says that from intoxication, pride manifests. Intoxication and pride destroy mercy and austerity. Gambling, from gambling, truth is destroyed. By unlawful association, a woman's purity is destroyed. By animal killing, cruelty manifests and mercy is destroyed. This is not contradictory to the previous statements that have been given. So the flow over there is a little different, but without going into too much details, at least the way that I could understand is the way Vishnu Chakri Thakur explains is that considering these cause and effects to be completely sequential, is good for us to understand, but from a practical perspective, there is a certain amount of parallelism that goes on. And that is why when there is, you know, when there is things that are happening concurrently, then you pick on anyone and talk about it, and in terms of cause and effect, they're all true. So then the analogy of a four-story house is not valid anymore. It's not that one is stacked on top of others. The, you know, the concurrent analogy would be that you have a plate with four kinds of food items on them. They're all at the same level. And then one gets mixed with another, which gets mixed with another. So where it starts and where it ends, it's a little difficult to determine. So that's why Srila Prabhupada and most of the acharyas, they explain it in this way. And my understanding is that they explain it in this way because, one, it is easier to understand. And the second is that even when there is parallelism, there is a predominance of cause and effect based on the axis that they have created. That yes, when humility goes, then pride comes. That is the first thing that goes, humility in the Satyuga. And when that pride comes, what happens is then one begins to question the scriptures. One begins to have a very high estimation of one's own values. And then as a result of that, one says that my tongue is important. One begins to say, and this is actually a real conversation I had with a person, he's a Muslim person. He is still a Muslim person, actually. And he was making the statement that God created animals for our pleasure. If we don't eat them, then we are essentially doing a disservice to God. So now I don't know enough about Quran to say that there is a statement that is there, but just this notion that for me to enjoy my senses, it is okay for me to kill another animal. So we can see that we can understand how this could be the root, because as long as we adhere to the scriptures, you cannot go wrong. So only when you start having more, giving more importance to your own speculation, then the deviation starts. And then after that, it is a spiral. One results in another, another results in another. That's the way that I could understood that there is some amount of linearity in this cause and effect.
Thank you, Raul.
Okay, so let me go on to the next verse, which is verse 26. Yam cha bhumir bhagvata nyasitrao bharasati shrimadvistat padanyasaha sarvataha krita kautukaha. The burden of the earth was certainly diminished by the personality of Godhead and by others as well. When he was present as an incarnation, all good was performed because of his auspicious footprints. So what Maharaj Parishad is doing now is that he is comparing the immediate past to the present. So when Krishna was present, then it was the Prabhu, you can take the table out now. We can go to the verse. So when Krishna was present, then it was like Satyug. Oh, looks like Prem Krishna Prabhu is gone. That's okay. So when Krishna was present, then even though it was Dwapar Yug, but for all practical purposes, because of his influence, it was like Satyug. And it was flourishing on all the four pillars. But in a very short time, it has rapidly jumped from Satyug to Kaliyug. So that notion of the gradual, so they have this analogy of a frog in water, and if you put a frog in hot water, it'll jump out. But if you put a frog in the water and heat the water gradually, it'll stay even to a much higher temperature. So what has happened now is that it has actually jumped from Satyug to Kaliyug, which is why the influence is being felt so strongly. Okay, next verse 27. So chatya shukala sadve durbhage vo jahita sati abharamanya nripavyaja shudra bhokshyanti mamiti. Now she, the chaste one, being unfortunately forsaken by the personality of Godhead, laments her future with tears in her eyes. For now she is being ruled and enjoyed by lower class men who pose as rulers. So Maharaj Parikshit at this point, he is turning his focus away from dharma and towards Bhumi Devi. So Parikshit Prabhu, we are Prem Kishore Prabhu, we are at verse 27. So dharma has, so Parikshit Maharaj is now turning his focus to Mother Earth. So he's saying to dharma that, my dear Dharma, you may be able to tolerate all your hardships because you're taking shelter of philosophy. But look at the condition of my mother. Look at the condition of Bhumi Devi. That she has tears in her eyes. She's lamenting. So essentially, this is a summary of chapter 16, where Bhumi Devi was sharing her lamentation with Dharma. That how she is bereaved with the absence of Krishna and how she is being enjoyed by Shudras that are dressed in the garb of a king. Now, factually speaking, the statement is not correct, because we have earlier on established that while Maharaj Parikshit was there, the influence of Kali was not there because of his personal influence. So considering the fact that this is a meditation of Maharaj Parikshit, so we can understand that Maharaj Parikshit is blurring the present with the near future. So what he's saying is going to happen very soon. And very soon means in a matter of a few days. So even in this verse, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he translates bhokshyanti to would enjoy, to the immediate future tense, as opposed to is being enjoyed. Prabhupada in the purport, he also acknowledges the fact that this is the near future. He says that is the future of the world in the age of Kali, where irreligiosity prevails most prominently, and in the absence of a suitable king to curb irreligious tendencies, educating the people systematically in the teaching of Srimad Bhagavatam will clear up the hazy atmosphere of corruption, bribery, blackmail, etc. So this section is basically telling that people who desire to be Krishna conscious, the only cure that is there is Bhagavatam. Krishna is gone, but he has reappeared in the form of Bhagavatam, and that is Prabhupada's recommendation. Okay, I'll do one more verse and then I'll stop. Verse 28. Iti dharmam ahim cheva santva yitva maharataha nishatam madade khadgam kalaye dharma hetave. Maharaj Parikshit, who could fight 1,000 enemies single-handedly, thus pacified the personality of religion and the earth. Then he took up a sharp sword to kill the personality of Kali, who is the cause of all irreligion. So Maharaj Parikshit taking up the sword is an expression of the intentions of the king. So what the king is thinking is that by seeing the sword in my hand, let this Shudra, dressed as a king, come and fight with me. When he fights with me, then I will quickly kill him. So this indicates that Maharaj Parikshit as a Kshatriya is not inclined to kill an unresisting enemy or an enemy that is not offering combat. But he's creating a situation in which combat follows and then he can honorably vanquish him. So one of the questions over here is that if Maharaj Parikshit knows that Kali is inevitable, then why is he even trying to kill Kali? So if even Krishna is not choosing to stop Kali, then why is Maharaj Parikshit thinking that he's more powerful than Krishna, that he will actually reverse the influence of Kali? So Prabhupada, in the purport, he gives a very nice analogy. So he says that in the rainy season, certainly there will be profuse rainfalls. But that does not mean that men should not take means to protect themselves from the rains. It is the duty of the executive head of states and others to take all necessary actions against the activities of Kali or the persons influenced by the age of Kali. And Maharaj Parikshit is the ideal executive head of state, for at once he was ready to kill the personality of Kali with his sharp sword. So Prabhupada gives the example that if it rains, then one should not simply say that rain is inevitable, so my getting wet is inevitable. But the person still takes the umbrella. So while it is raining, then even then the person is not influenced by the effect of rain. So that is what is understood by Parikshit Maharaj getting ready to kill Kali is to getting ready to negate the influences of Kali. And that we will see in the remaining verses, that how he prepares to negate the influence of Kali. I'm a little over time, but if there are some questions or comments, we can spend a few minutes discussing them. Okay, if not, then we'll stop over here. Vanchakalpata rubhayaschet kripa sindhu bevacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namah anant koti vaishnavrind ki jai shila prabhupad ki jai nithai gaur prem anand hari 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 krishna.